Good afternoon and welcome back to Exploring the Word on AFR Talk. Jim Stanley with Dr. Alex McFarland and Mr. Andrew Davis, by the way, not Davies. I apologize for that. And see, if I called you Andrew, I'd be okay.
You would. You can. I'd like that.
Well, Andrew, it is good to have you on this afternoon. And if folks, if you're wondering why he's here, this is probably one of the best shows for him to be on because he is an evangelist. He is a big part of Behold Your God, which is the series that American Family Studios has put out that talks about rethinking God biblically. And Alex, can we pause for just a moment on the study of Zechariah and come back to it in just a moment?
Let's do. And I want to say, Mr. Davis, it is an honor to have you on the show today. And we just thank you for making time to do that.
Well, thank you. It's a privilege to be here. And I'm appreciating it.
Now, during the filming of Behold Your God and during the different teachings that went on with this, help us understand where have we gotten, and especially, and I say America because I think sometimes we drift further than others, and of course we can look to Europe and see where some of that has drifted as well. What does it mean to rethink God biblically?
Yes. I think one of the things that has struck me over the years and in my own ministry is the way in which the Bible begins with God, ends with God, and the whole message of the Bible really is about God's activity in history. I remember somebody saying once that, in a sense, it doesn't really matter theoretically whether you can prove the existence of God. The question is, has he done anything? And he certainly has. So the Bible is about his works of creation, his work of providence, and his wonderful works of redemption. And that central theme of the Bible can sometimes be marginalized. It can be marginalized in all kinds of ways. It can be marginalized, for example, in a regular expository biblical ministry where you go through a book without actually relating that book or the message of that book to the whole message of the Bible. So the Bible is a book about God and not primarily about us, but when we really find out who God is, we begin to see what we are like, and not only that, but we begin to see why Christ came, who he is, why the Holy Spirit has come, what he does, how this impacts on worship and witness and holiness, how it affects church life, how it affects our preaching of the gospel, how it affects the whole life of the Christian in the community at large, both church and society. So the purpose of the gospel is not just to make us happy, though a Christian is a joyful person, but to bring us to God. And that must be the most important single thing in the world for all human beings. And the purpose of the gospel is just to bring God to us and to bring us to God.
Amen. Amen.
Alex, you're an evangelist. How important is that to you, and how often do you run into the point that people aren't thinking of God biblically anymore?
You know, I read a story about some children, and they were going to play hide-and-seek, and they played a trick on one little boy, and they let him go hide, and he hid for hours and finally came out realizing that his friends had left him. And the little boy had asked his dad a few days before, what is it like to be God? And the dad said, well, that question is unanswerable. So the little boy comes crying to his father after this game, and he says, Father, no one is seeking me. And the dad said, that's probably what it feels like to be God. And I think that in and of ourselves, we don't seek God. If we do seek God, it's because the Holy Spirit is drawing us. Mm. But so many people have a wrong view of God, that he is maybe a cosmic concierge who exists to serve us and enhance our experience here on earth. Mm. But in reality, as we know, he is a holy God, a righteous God. He's worthy of worship. And the truth is that without God, we're nothing. And I think that so many people, especially in affluent, prosperous America, we believe a lie. We believe that happiness and fulfillment is found in things, whereas, like Augustine said, the heart is restless till it rests in thee. We'll never be whole and complete till we worship our Creator and know Him as forgiver and Savior.
Yeah, that's profoundly true. You think of that question that God put to Adam and Eve in the garden, where are you? They should have really been asking God that question. But it was he who asked them the question. And the wonderful thing is that he asks the question because he really does love us and he wants us to know him and has made provision in Christ that we should know him. And that's a marvelous thing.
Wow, that's good.
Pastor Davis, I want to quote a Christian song, and I'd love your response, because the gospel story, as evangelist to evangelist, it is the greatest story. There's an old hymn, and it contains the lyric, "Oh, the love that drew salvation's plan, oh, the grace that brought it down to man, oh, the mighty gulf that God did span at Calvary." I want you to comment on that and explain to us what that means.
Yes, that's just a wonderful song. I do know it, and we do sing it back in Wales. Yes, it just means that between us and God there is this infinite, infinite gulf or gap in terms of our being human and He being God, in terms of our being sinful and He being perfect and holy. Who's to bridge that gap? Who's to cross the gulf? Only God Himself can do that, and in Christ, the Son of God became a man for us in order that He might bridge that gulf between us and God so that God becomes accessible to us and He can reveal Himself to us and we can come to know Him. But that means that not only did Christ come to be the incarnate Son of God who in His own person became human, but also took our sins, took the punishment we deserve, took the judgment that we rightly incur because of our sinfulness and sin. And He has taken that away. He's borne our sins in His body on the tree. He's taken the wrath of God upon Himself so that we could be reconciled to God. And therefore this gulf, this gap is bridged. And human beings are brought to God and God is brought to them. And there's this wonderful new relationship with God, which is real and living and purposeful and eternal. It's the meaning of life, yeah.
There's no way we could cross that chasm apart from Jesus.
No, He is the only one. I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me.
Yeah. Well, you're listening to Exploring the Word on AFR Talk. I'm Jim Stanley alongside Andrew Davis and our friend Dr. Alex McFarland, and co-host is here as well. Guys, want to touch base real quick about beholdyourgod.org. Beholdyourgod.org. There you can find some of the materials. It is an excellent 12-week study for churches, small groups, families, and it's a DVD. And on this DVD, these guys spent a good part of a year going and talking with different individuals, filming different scenes and different things that are in here. And I can't encourage you enough to visit that. You have an introduction and the first week's Bible study, which is free to see if it's something that you would enjoy or not. And then after that, you can order the material if you so desire. Beholdyourgod.org is the website there. Mr. Davis, every now and then, it's good. I don't believe things happen by accident. I think that God is God, and he ordains different things. You mentioned during your talk just a moment ago about reconciliation. Perhaps we have someone that's just tuned in, and they don't understand necessarily what it means to be reconciled to God. Where does reconciliation come from, and how does it happen?
Yes, it comes from God Himself, and the place of reconciliation is the cross of Christ, where God Himself has dealt with our sin and dealt with His own anger against our sin through Christ, who has borne both our sin and the anger of God upon it, so that the enmity, which is mutual, it's God who is our enemy and we who are His enemy, that enmity, particularly from God's side, has been removed in the sacrifice of Christ, who has taken our place, been our substitute, borne our sin in Himself upon the cross. So that reconciliation between God and man was made at the cross when Jesus died, and because he rose again, because he is the living Lord, this becomes a living reality to us when we turn to Christ, when we realize that we are God's enemies as well and repent of our sins. That means that we really turn away from our sins, that we do a U-turn, if you like, and like the prodigal son, come to ourselves and return to our Father. When we repent of our sins and turn our back upon it and say, I'm sorry, Lord, please forgive me, have mercy on me. And when, at the same time, we put all our trust in Christ who has made reconciliation in the death of his cross, we have peace with God. And peace with God is followed by peace of mind. But the essential thing is that we have peace with God. So there's a mutual drawing together of God and us through the cross and through the sacrifice of Christ, who is God and man in one person, and who is alive, so that we know him as a living Lord in our lives, and that's a great and a marvelous thing to happen to us.
Amen. Amen. That,
one second,
Pastor,
Alex.
And it's on the Behold Your God website, which is a very wonderful site, beholdyourgod.org. You've got some pictures of some great leaders of years past, one of whom I think I saw a picture on there of A.W. Tozer. Did I see that correctly?
Yes, you did.
I had the privilege of writing a chapter. There's a book out called Inspired by Tozer, and it's about the life and ministry of Tozer. And I wrote a chapter for that book. But for those that may be unfamiliar with this great leader of years past, tell us a little bit about Tozer and maybe about some of the other leaders referenced on the site.
Yes, well, my knowledge of Tozer is really about the way in which he brought this message to people, the reality, the centrality, and the wonder of God, and how easy it is for us to forget him and to marginalize him, even in church life and even in our individual lives, if we are Christians. Books like The Pursuit of God, the need to know God, not just doctrinally in our heads, but experimentally in our hearts, the need to be humbled in the presence of God, to realize that we are human, we are sinful, he is God, we are to bow before him in worship. Just the glory and the wonder of God in our lives, as well as in history and in providence and in grace. Tozer brought that message into the evangelical world, and I think it's a message that is urgently needed today. People like David Wells have said similar things, that if God lies inconsequentially with us, then we are lost, we are undone.
You're listening to Exploring the Word on AFR Talk. We'll be back with Mr. Andrew Davies and Dr. Alex McFarland right after this.